Hello, and welcome to the President's Panel on Transfer Success. This panel is part of our fourth annual Florida Conference on the Acceleration of Transfer Success, sponsored by Helios Education Foundation. I'm your host today, Michael Preston. I serve as the Executive Director of the Florida Consortium of Metropolitan Research Universities. Our consortium is comprised of Florida International University, University of Central Florida, and the University of South Florida, along with our collaborative partner for this event, Florida Atlantic University. We are excited to present this discussion today. Please note that this discussion has been pre-recorded, so we won't have an opportunity for any live comments or questions in the chat. However, we do encourage you to put some of those questions in the chat so that we can answer them at a later date. Also, we would encourage you to have any comments that you have for the entire group to make sure that you tab down and tab everyone in that question so that it doesn't just go to one or two people and everyone can see your comments. Today's session will focus on transfer success and collaboration through the lens of our state college and university leadership. And I'm honored to be joined by two outstanding higher ed leaders and champions of transfer success in the state of Florida. Here in Florida, transfer pathways have become the primary path for many of our students seeking a baccalaureate degree, and the members of the Florida Consortium and their distinctive universities account for 65% of all Florida college system transfer students. This is accomplished by partnerships with great state colleges like Miami-Dade College. MDC was recently awarded in 2019 the Aspen Prize for College Excellence and has had a long-standing partnership with FIU through their Connect for Success program. Joining me today are the leaders of those institutions, Dr. Mark B. Rosenberg of Florida International University and Dr. Madeline Pumariega, President, Miami-Dade College. Thank you both for joining me and our statewide audience out there in the world, I guess. So I'm going to get started with some of the questions if you both are ready. There's an old saying that you can't look forward until you look in the past, and both of you have had various leadership roles when it comes to helping our Florida State colleges and universities prepare for transfer success. In your experience, where did Florida's unique commitment to transfer success begin, and why are we such a leader in this space? I'm going to start with you.
Thanks, Michael. It's great to be here and join my friend, President Rosenberg. I think that the pillars of articulation and transfer success in Florida really started in the 70s. It really began with a statewide articulation agreement. It solidified itself in the 90s with the common numbering system. It strengthened itself with general education core courses, you know, in the late 90s, where the Associates of Arts previously could have been 62 credits, 64 credits. During Governor Bush's administration, the legislature passed 60 credit Associates of Arts program. And I think that aligns to one early in the 70s, the articulation agreement, in the 90s, the common numbering system, and then a real pathway for students to be able to transfer seamlessly among our colleges and our universities. And I think we've only built on that. The commitment of the college presidents, the university presidents, to continue to strengthen the 2+2 via targeted pathways or just between faculty to faculty collaboration. But we are, as you say, really a leader in the nation around articulation and 2+2 success.
Thanks. And from a university perspective, how does transfer students really strengthen our university system?
Transfers in many ways is our bread and butter. Largely for those of us who are urban universities, we have a large urban population that needs educational services 24/7, 365. And so our use of transfer is a way to keep their educational hopes alive on one hand, and also to make it easy for all parties involved to understand what they're bringing in, what they can apply to a given major and or specialization, and how much we're going to need to graduate. And for individuals who may be working full or part-time, or who may be place-bound and have major family responsibilities, that kind of information helps them to graduate timely, which is what both Miami-Dade and FIU are all about, timely graduation.
Speaking of which, Miami-Dade College and FIU have been partners for many years. While this is a partnership that has grown and over the years tens of thousands of students have graduated, there still seems to be, in the state of Florida and with any partnership, barriers to baccalaureate transfer. Part of our work in the Florida Consortium, through our partners with Helios Education Foundation, is to try and figure out ways to help streamline some of those processes a little bit more. What do each of you perceive as some of those barriers that we need to address here in the, like, 2020s, I guess, is where we're at?
Information, good advising, financial aid is a huge issue that we're concerned with. And even though we have significant prosperity in our state that we're very proud of, that both the state college and the universities are contributing to, we know that there is very deep financial need among, in particular, our students. So we are working on finding ways to ensure, even though we have the Common Course numbering system, even though we have the articulation agreements, even though we have a very positive mindset towards finding ways to make it happen, we know that there are countless big and little things that get in our students' ways, and I've named some of them.
Absolutely. From a community college standpoint?
Yeah, I would just add, I think that there are some high schools where there's much more of a college-going culture. Oftentimes, maybe those students' parents have already gone to college and they have those aspirations for their children. But there's still many of our high schools, many of our families, particularly in Miami-Dade County and really across the state, that still don't believe that college is for them, that they don't see a path there. So I think there's still more work to do to make sure that we create those strong access points, and whether it's early college opportunities, whether it's campus and college tours, as the president said, strengthening financial aid, not only federal Pell, but also what we do around the state. I think we've done great in terms of Bright Futures. And if you are a student, you know, graduating with those top grades, you know Florida has a path for you in the Bright Futures program. But if you're a middle income family just trying to figure things out, you're not sure if you can afford college. So I think the more we can talk about the communication about affordability, and then build on the 2+2, especially with areas like in healthcare and technology and STEM areas that we see our community needs in terms of jobs and does create economic prosperity for families.
That really helps segue to my next question here, and that is, at this summit, we were provided with some evidence that a pathway to graduation is more than a degree for many of our students here in the state, but it's really a social justice imperative. When I use the term social justice imperative and college success, what comes to mind?
So I would say increasing our college attainment rates, our educational attainment. You know, you saw the governor sign in his first 100 days for Florida to be number one in workforce. How do you measure if we're number one in workforce? We do through educational attainment. And it doesn't mean it's just baccalaureate, it's high quality certificates, it's associates, it's bachelor's degree. And I believe that it's not only just the social imperative, it really is an economic imperative. Talent is the new economic currency for states and communities that don't have the strong talent pool. They're going to lose out in terms of economic growth. So I look at it and I think it's a moral imperative that we make sure that we create pathways for individuals to be able to get that career, that job, that life sustaining for their families. It's certainly a social imperative in building those pathways towards prosperity. But most importantly, it's an economic, you know, imperative in terms of continuing to grow Florida, and especially right here in Miami-Dade County, making sure that businesses that come here, that start up here, have an opportunity to thrive here, because we've got the right talent pool for them.
I would assume you agree.
Yeah, I think that there you're one of the messages really that's being sent is that we expect students to continue their educations into the state college system, and we expect them, if they want to, depending upon their degree, to continue into the university. And for a lot of students, our expectations may be the only expectations that they feel, that because those expectations may not be coming from their work site, if they work on one hand, or they may not be coming from their home or their peers or their siblings on the other. So I think there's a lot of this that is mindset, and that, we expect you to get a college education, and we expect you to graduate timely. And if you do, we expect that you're going to help lift your families out of difficulty and into better circumstances. So I think we as educators have to make sure that we're speaking to that expectation, and that we understand that we play a critical role in uplift. And I think, truthfully, most of us in the state college system, in the state university system, are proud of that. We get that, and our frustration is we can't do more.
Sure. And in many ways, we think about this in terms of scale.
Yeah.
As you know, President Rosenberg, FIU is a very large university, one of the largest universities in the country.
Right.
When you have that complex of an organization, how do you create a culture that fosters transfer success, or that thinks about transfer students in a way that makes that student feel like they're an individual?
Well, first of all, we have a sense of the importance of taking responsibility for the well-being of our community and the well-being of our students. I think that issue of mindset related to the values that drive our purpose-driven work, that's very important. That's one. Two is that we've tried to get away from the blame game. We've tried to understand how each of us has a responsibility for ensuring that our students are ready by the time they graduate from Miami-Dade, in this case, or state colleges more generally, and they come into the university, and we're willing to accept the notion that if they may not be ready, it's as much our fault as anybody else's, because we know what the expectations are, we know what the requirements are. What is the matter with us if we continue to not be able to communicate that to our partners? So my point is the willingness to take responsibility to make sure that students are, when they come into the university, that they're ready. And that means me communicating well, working better with our partners, in this case, Miami-Dade. And of course, we've had, for as long as I can remember, at least two decades, we've had an annual major articulation meeting where we tackle the problems head on that might be, if you will, barriers to our students successfully graduating from Miami-Dade and getting into FIU. And I'm really proud of that tradition that we have. There's so much more we're also doing now, but I think it's mindset and willingness to take responsibility regardless of where the student's coming from. By the way, I feel the same way, and we feel the same way about students who are coming directly from high school and graduating and coming into FIU. And in that, we feel that way because 35%, more or less, at least up until a few years ago, of those teachers in the Dade County Public Schools were FIU graduates. So if we're not satisfied with the quality of the student arriving or the preparation, again, we need to look at ourselves first to see how we can improve that, because after all, many of our graduates and many of Miami-Dade's graduates are the ones who are teaching those kids who are now coming into Miami-Dade or FIU.
Wow, it sure is a full cycle. And President Pumariega, nationally, no, this is nationally, I think we actually beat these numbers, but I'll go with the national numbers so that we can be more impressive here.
We are number one in the nation in higher education, so
there
I'm
you
sure
go.
We beat some of those national numbers.
Absolutely. So nationally, 80% of community college students begin by anticipating that they're going to transfer and achieve their baccalaureate degree. Unfortunately, only about 15% end up doing so. While our numbers, once again, I'm pretty sure they're a lot better than that, we still see momentum broken a lot of times with many students who might come to MDC and then for whatever reason don't end up at FIU. How do you identify what some of those momentum breakers are at MDC and then address them through your staff and professionals there?
So as the president said earlier, there's lots of reasons, right? And one is that it's never that a student woke up and decided to give up on their dreams. But life happens. Small and big things happen. Taking care of parents or grandparents, taking care of siblings, having to go to work. And those are the kinds of obstacles that get in the way of students being able to finish. And so what we're doing, you know, the Hope Center did a survey during COVID. 77% of our students at Miami-Dade College said they were either housing insecure or food insecure. How precisely will you focus on your goals if you're hungry and if you're not sure where you're going to sleep that evening? So I think working on collaborative partnerships with community agencies, looking at emergency grant funding and being able to get that to students who sometimes academic careers derailed because of a flat tire. While you and I might have a flat tire, call AAA and it's an inconvenience, for some students, it ends that right there. And so I think doing those emergency grants are important, creating strong advising pathways so that they know the why they're in this course, the purpose to it and how it is connected to, you know, their nursing degree or a degree in teaching or engineering. And I think the other part is implementing early alerts with our faculty so that we're not looking at data in the rears, but we're really looking at data to help provide those real-time interventions and support for students. But I want to say, you know, what the president said, it is a mindset. You know, we have a growth mindset. We want to impart in our students to have that same growth mindset. And when you do, that means you learn from places that the data says, boy, our hard work isn't reflective in that data. And then you also double down on your efforts to provide support for students and look at wherever there's a gap, how do we get intentional about closing it?
Well, thinking about kind of the impacts of COVID-19, certainly that has been something that has been really disruptive in higher education in general, but particularly for our nation's community colleges. How have you seen that impact on kind of the transfer going population as we're seeing it now? And when do you expect us to quote unquote return to normal?
I don't think we ever return to normal. This is the new normal. It means enhancing teaching modalities. It means fine-tuning what we do in a virtual and digital environment. I think that students, some will come back, others won't. They have pivoted into a new job, which right now for them is probably a priority. When we called students and asked them, why didn't you come back? There were three things they said. Number one, my job. Whenever they tell me I need to work, I need to be flexible enough to be able to pick up the hours for my family. Second is that they were taking care of someone elderly at home. And really a distant third was their health. We didn't see so much as the concern of health like it was balancing life. I have to work and I have to take care of siblings that now are at home and not at school. And so I don't know that we get back to normal. I do think that we're going to need to build and continue to build those bridges for students who now are working and creating what we've done previously, but now at a whole nother level, the flexible scheduling and flexible learning and support so that they can come back and finish that degree and then transfer. I would still say that the large majority of our students are interested in finishing their AA and then transferring to FIU. So the stronger we build those linkages, the better we get them on that pathway to come in and accomplish their goals of having that bachelor's degree.
Well, let's hope that we get there as a unit here. So COVID-19 and FIU,
how's
the recovery coming? And
yeah, I think that they're, I agree completely with President Pumariega that we're not getting back to normal. There's a new normal and we got to embrace it. They think that several things are required to embrace it. Clarity of understanding about what the real options are in 2021 as a consequence of the pandemic. Intentionality, meaning a deliberate effort to, implement new initiatives and a willingness to fail, but to at least experiment and not cling to the old models. I think that beyond clarity and intentionality, that creativity is very, very important now. We've got to find newer and better ways to meet students where they are. We've got to find newer and better ways to make sure they understand what's at risk if they don't get their educations. And we do have to find more resources, particularly to foster completion and them getting their educations done. And then finally, flexibility. I don't see enough flexibility in our education systems, maybe for a couple of reasons. First of all, we have a usually thoughtful regulatory framework that we have to work under that may not really be set up for the challenges that we as educators face, particularly as it relates to students who have come through a great deal of trauma and difficulty. We need flexibility within our units to be willing to experiment and not to have fear of failure. We need that. We need to do a lot better there. We need to find out as well what works a little bit more quickly and celebrate that and share that. So I'm actually excited about what's ahead. We have demographics in the state of Florida. Those demographics are better than in most other states of the United States. And as a consequence, we've got work. And so we've got opportunities to help a lot of people. But we do need a little bit more clarity and intentionality. And I'm confident that gatherings like this, like that we're doing in the Metro Consortium, can help to drive that.
Well, the Board of Governors has heard that call and is delivering in some way with a new transfer success metric that's mm-hmm. going to be part of our mm-hmm. performance metrics. How's FIU preparing for this transfer success metric, and how do you think it might change the way that you approach transfer success?
Well, I'd like to think it wouldn't change it at all, to be candid with you, we think it's important, and we're doing it because it's important, even if it's now part of the funding and the metrics dynamics. But what gets measured gets done. I do believe that. I think that we've learned a lot about measurement in the last decade, and I think it's for the positive. I know that there are excesses in terms of at times the focus on measurement, but I think that the gains far outweigh the negatives. And so I feel that as we can embed the transfer success metrics into our mindsets and our thinking, and we actually get the numbers and we see how well we're doing, I'm confident. We're a very competitive group in education. People don't think we're very competitive. We are, and we like to show that we can get things done. So I'm really confident. I think this will help a lot. So I'm okay with it. I'm okay. And actually, it does finally begin to recognize, if you will, the a metric of measurement that goes beyond the traditional four-year land-grant-centric, Ivy-centric set of measures that have little to do with the reality of the communities that we represent at Miami-Dade and FIU. So I'd like to see more metrics that were equally sensitive to the particular mission that we have in these large urban areas like Miami, Tampa, Orlando, Greater Fort Lauderdale, Broward. That's where the population is, and the incentives need to be structured around their realities, and I think this gets at that.
I think you're right, and I can speak on behalf of all the transfer success professionals in the Florida Consortium. They were excited to see the metric because it gives them a target, and they're really excited about that target. So, President Pumariega, you've been around this whole kind of both the policy making and thinking about some of these metrics as they're being developed. What gets you excited about the transfer success metric and what you're going to expect as a president of one of our state colleges?
So I'm incredibly optimistic that the new 2+2, the new metric, will strengthen our partnership with our universities. It is going to require some of that intentionality about making sure that students have strong academic pathways so that there's no loss of credit as they transfer in. It's going to require resources, thinking about a statewide transfer scholarship. Just like we have Bright Futures, how can we make sure that we remove any of the financial barriers for our transfer students? It's going to require some intentionality about being able to provide on-campus work opportunities for our transfer students, because many are working while they study. When we survey our students, more than 80% have a job while they're finishing their AA. Once they get to the university in that junior and senior year, is that still possible? The money's still possible for them. They're going to still need that. But how do we build those stronger partnerships? But I am optimistic. I know that Florida today outperforms the rest of the nation. And I expect the president and I to work collaboratively and outperform the rest of the state and be the model of 2+2 success.
So I have two folks here that have a unique perspective of being both chancellor and president. So put on your forward-thinking cap. Think about 20 years into the future. What do these agreements look like between our state colleges and our universities and higher education in general? How does it change? How does it look the same?
Well, I think first of all, you have two people, two educators who clearly are on one hand, institutionalists, and on the other, believe in systems. So I think that we've seen the best of both worlds, and truthfully, we've seen the worst of both worlds in terms of our leadership responsibilities in the state of Florida. My instinct, if we look ahead, if we fast forward two decades, is that we will continue to see strong institutions. We know that individuals want identity and identification with institutions they believe in. And clearly both Miami-Dade College and FIU are community pillars because we provide value. And I believe the same can be said for most other of our state colleges and universities in Florida. And in providing value 20 years from now, what it will look like is that the pathways will be more seamlessly followed by our students. So a student who would be in Tampa and have to move to Miami or vice versa knows that he or she is going to walk right in to the state college and get their education, and then that they will know, they will have confidence that if they're at Miami-Dade, that they're going to be fully informed and prepared for what's next, whether it's FIU or a transfer to another institution, on one hand. On the other, I see a convergence between vocational and baccalaureate education, largely because of tech as a driver of, if you will, that convergence. Tech, automation, and robotics, if you will. So I see, if you will, a learning environment that is far more robust and far more capable of addressing the range of competencies and needs that our demographics will have and the economy will demand over the next 20 years. So I'm an optimist. I believe we will survive. I think there's still a need for bricks and mortar. I believe that place matters on one hand, but I believe that tech will enable us to be far more fluid in realizing that.
So I would say, you know, if we look back the last 20 years, and as the president said, we were both chancellors within the last two decades, which disruption in higher education really was driven through policy. I think the next two decades, the disruption in higher education will be driven by consumers and will be driven by the need for talent. There is, you know, any kind of the analytics you look at, we're going to have far more jobs than we have people for those jobs. And that in itself will be a disruptive factor. I think the way that right now we look at articulation is just this credit pathway, the blurring of non-credit and credit, much more of skill acquisition versus credit accumulation. I think that our students are going to have to graduate with three distinctive skill sets. One is the applied knowledge skill set, what we know traditionally today as our general education core. I think that's still going to be important over the next two decades, right? Having a global citizen is going to be incredibly important. The next set of skills are those future-proof skills, because students in the future are going to transfer from job to job. It's not going to be the career-long type of it, and I think it's the disruption in technology and automation and artificial intelligence, and then the digital skills that are going to be required for students to be competitive in the workforce, which is going to be a workforce that we have seen through COVID, a much faster adoption of technology and much more digitization of everything that we do. And I think our institutions are going to be nimble enough to handle it. There's often folks say that higher education isn't nimble enough. Well, we've demonstrated during a pandemic to pivot an entire industry to a virtual environment, still been able to graduate students collectively. Both of our institutions this past May probably graduated 25,000 students into the community with credentials that led right into a job. And I think that's the future. It's an exciting one, I think, for higher education. And I think it's going to only underscore the type of partnerships that we're going to need to have with business and industry and government and policymakers and among and between our own institutions.
Well, it sounds like a bright future is ahead of us.
We're both optimists, as you can see.
I'd love to hear it. So any final parting thoughts?
Well, this gathering, our meeting, and the broader context, I hope further galvanizes the purposes that bring our staffs and our faculties together to do right by our students, to foster student success, to take the franchise that we've been given as state state employees to ensure that we are opening opportunities, keeping doors open, providing value in efficient means, getting our students graduated, But that's not enough. Getting them into great jobs, getting them into positions of if you will, ethical leadership, civic leadership, and uplifting our community, if we can commit to that, and part as a consequence of our efforts here, I think the state's going to continue to be in really good hands.
Fantastic. Final word?
I would just say to these convenings are so important because they really give everyone an opportunity to share some of the best practices, but most important, to be reminded of our why. Why we do the work that we do is about economic mobility. There is probably not a greater impact is the power of education, the power of that high value credential that leads into a life sustaining wage. That is so important. And we do this through our students. They come to us with a dream. And the dream is to be able to do exactly what we do, right? We are lucky. We get to live out our purpose, our passion every day. It's what our students come to us for. And so how do we make sure that we keep building those strong pathways, that we are reminded that every student has a dream, and their dream is to exactly fulfill their talents and be able to contribute to society in meaningful ways. And we as a higher education community have an obligation to those students, and we have an obligation to our state to make sure that we produce the talent that our state needs and provides those kinds of opportunities for our students. So our work is incredibly important. Probably this is the most important time for education, and especially for higher education and the partnerships that I know everyone that's watching, everyone in the room, and that we have with one another.
Thank you. And thank you for joining us today. I want to thank both President Rosenberg and President Pumariega for their time and their talent this afternoon. We are truly in good hands when we have leaders like them leading us into the future. On behalf of the Florida Consortium and the Transfer Success Network, I'd like to thank you for joining us. Make sure that you put any comments in the chat, as well as any questions that you have, and we'll try and get to all of them. And come back in about 15 minutes, and we will resume the conference. We'll be right back.